proteins. They're molecular building blocks that make our bodies work. Yet, much is still unknown about their 3D spatial structure or their dynamics that make them function. And while proteins build structural support, make muscles contract, and help fight infection, they can sometimes misfold, causing them to stick together where they aren't meant to, and the results can be devastating. Alzheimer's disease affects nearly 5 million Americans and their families. It occurs when abnormally misfolded proteins form large plaques within the brain, destroying a person's memory, ability to function, who they are. In order to study the proteins that cause neurodegenerative disorders like Alzheimer's and the effects of traumatic brain injury, scientists use structural biology, including chemical labeling, to track proteins as they interact with each other. But experiments can be difficult and expensive. At the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab, researchers Plamen Demirev and Sanjay Varma have discovered a new method using a short pulse laser that produces the same labeling results at a fraction of the cost.
Currently, one method to study proteins and large protein complexes in their native environment, like water, is biomolecular footprinting. To do biomolecular footprinting, you need powerful X-rays, which are generated in synchrotron facilities. Unfortunately, a synchrotron costs about $1 billion, and that's why there's only a few such facilities worldwide. That's also the reason why a lot of the protein chemists and molecular biologists who want to use them don't have that opportunity. We developed a method that uses femtosecond very short pulse lasers to do biomolecular footprinting of proteins for a fraction of the cost very quickly right here in our lab.
The laser system that you see behind me is an ultra-short laser pulse system. The pulses that it puts out are 40 femtoseconds long. A femtosecond is a millionth of a billionth of a second. A 40 femtosecond pulse isn't like a laser beam that you would normally see. Instead of a beam, it's a disc. A 40 femtosecond pulse is 12 microns long, so it's a disc that's thinner than a third of the thickness of an average human hair. All of that laser energy is packed into a very small package, so it's very, very intense. X-rays are known to break molecular bonds, and even though our femtosecond pulse is infrared, it's so intense that it breaks molecular bonds just like an X-ray does. When it hits a water molecule, for example, it breaks the water molecule up from H2O to an H and an OH. The OH is a hydroxyl radical, and that's an important part of our labeling process.
It's very important to know how proteins stick together, which parts are exposed to the water, which parts are protected. So when the femtosecond laser interacts with the water and generates the hydroxyl radicals, those radicals find their way around the protein, and they attach only to the exposed parts of the protein, and that's how they label it.
Here you can see the part of the protein that was sticking to the other was not labeled, since it was protected. The green part of the protein is lighter than the red part, and by using mass spectrometry, we can differentiate the parts and figure out where and when the proteins aggregate.
Unfortunately, we don't know much about protein aggregation, and that's a problem because protein aggregates cause a whole lot of neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, traumatic brain injuries, which all irreversibly damage the brain.
The labeling tests aren't done enough because they require high-power X-rays that are available in only a handful of facilities worldwide. However, with our technique, we can do very similar labeling with a laser that's available in just about any research university in the country.
With their findings published in journals like Optical Engineering, APL's Sanjay Varma and Plamen Demirev hope that biologists can begin to use this method to better identify proteins and understand neurodegenerative diseases. Before we can try to prevent Alzheimer's, we need to know all its causes and how it develops. The important work studying proteins in the brain can now be done in more places than ever. With it, maybe soon, we'll be able to offer something to more families than ever. Hope.